Welcome to Mountain West. It's Sunday. You made it. So glad you made it. My name is Joe.
And my name is Lydia. If you are watching in person, online, or in one of our video venues, we just want to say welcome to the best day of the week. This week, we are continuing our new series, Happy. So, you have made it to a great time.
Absolutely, and first-time guests.
Thank you so much. For those who are coming for the first time, we just want to personally welcome you. Thank you so much for coming here. This is a place that looks like hope and feels like home. So please make yourselves comfortable. If you are new, go ahead and fill out our online Connect card. Or if you're here in person, we also have the card that they pass to you inside the gathering. And yeah, we have a link or a QR code that will lead you to that information to fill out. So welcome, and thank you for being a part of our series today.
Yes. So, listen, we have a lot going here at Mountain West, and how do you stay updated? By following our social medias. If you don't do Facebook, we got Instagram. If you don't Instagram, we got, I don't even know.
Come on.
Do we have Threads? Do we have X? I don't know. We have a lot. Look, we're the same name everywhere.
That one.
So we would love to be connected with you. We want you to know what's going on at all times, ahead of time, so you can plan for it.
Yes.
Right? You can even see recaps. You know, one of my favorite things to do is find something, like if I'm looking. If I was in a reel or in one of the photos, I'm
sharing
on social media. Do all that. We want to stay connected with you, so please follow us in the Mountain West pages.
Beautiful. Also, coming up tonight at 6:30, we have our young adults gathering.
Woo!
So people like you and me, if you're 18 or through 30 years old.
I feel excluded.
That's okay. Maybe next
you
year.
You and me. I'm sitting right here, Lydia. Go on.
But if you are within that age range, please come on down back to the church. It will be an amazing experience. Last time was so fun. We just had a time of fellowship and discussion, and we had snacks, and we had bonding, and it was just a great time. So please make your way down if you have the time this evening. We'd love to have you.
All right. So Family Connect, April 28th is our next Family Connect. We have them every fourth Sunday of the month. And that's where we have it in the patio. That's the backside of the building where you see the turf. That's where parents who have young children come together and connect. We believe here you should do things in community. You don't have to do anything alone. We want to connect with you. I have three little boys. There's other people who have little girls, little boys, and they want to play together. And you want to, sometimes you just want to vent, like, oh my goodness, these kids are crazy.
Yeah.
You know? It's just one event, but whatever you got to do to come on out, please remember it's on the fourth Sunday, and that's during every gathering.
Yes.
Family Connect, April 28th.
Speaking about a father with three boys,
they
wouldn't have boys without mothers.
Oh, and that transition was good.
12, we have our Mother's Day, which happens to fall on a Sunday, and of course, that is a designated day for our beautiful mothers out there. Please. Bring your mothers to church. We have a fun little surprise for them, and we really want to take the day to celebrate, thank, pray, and honor our mothers that day. So please bring them on over to Mountain West Church.
You know, I had a quick thought, like, what if their mother goes to another church? This is a great, hey, look, Mom, every time we go to your church, come to our church this time.
I know, that's right.
Right? So listen, I'm excited for Mother's Day. I think that, you know, that's up there with Christmas Day and Easter. Like, that's a big day.
I agree.
All right, so graduation recognition, May 19th. Mm. If you are a high school senior this year, if you're a college senior this year, we would love to publicly salute you, recognize you, celebrate you, honor you for your hard work, all those papers, all those tests, all those quizzes. It's done. It's over with.
We
want to clap our hands and say, we're so happy you made it through.
Amen.
Now, please register for that, okay? And you scan the QR code, and we want to make sure we're prepared to celebrate you. Do that by May 6th.
And real quick, we do have our Mountain West summer camps. More information will come afterwards for high schoolers and middle schoolers. So parents, if you are interested in sending your kids away, please make a note of that, and we will give you more information after service.
Yes. All right. Well, we're at that time. It's time for praise and worship. It's time for a word of God. Prepare our hearts and minds for this gathering.
Amen.
Let us go.
morning, Mountain West. Come on, everybody on your feet. Put your hands together. Sing it out. I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. Amen. Well, hey, good morning, you guys. Good morning. How are you? Good, good. Thank you. Thank you guys for joining us this morning. We are so glad you guys are here. It's the best day of the week. Those of you guys joining online in our video venue, welcome to church today. It's going to be an awesome day. And let's start it right by turning around. Find somebody, give them a high five, give them a handshake, give them a fist bump. Let them know you're glad they're here today. And we're just going to keep worshiping together. Let's worship our Savior. Oh, the perfect Son of God, in all his innocence, here walking in the dirt with you and me, knows what living is. He's acquainted with our grief. A man of sorrow, son of suffering. Blood and tears, how can it be? Is it God who weeps? Is it God who pleads? Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah. Distant and removed, but you chased us down in merciful pursuit. To the sinner you were grace, and the broken you embrace. And in the end the proof is in your wounds. Yes, in the end the proof is there's a God who weeps, there's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Hallelujah, my freedom, your stripes, my healing, all praise, King Jesus, glory to God forever. Your blood still speaking, your love still reaching, all praise, King Jesus, glory to God forever. Your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing, all praise, King Jesus, glory to God forever. Your blood still speaking, your love still reaching, all praise, King Jesus, glory to God. blood and tears. Come on, sing that out. How can it be that there's a God who weeps? There's a God who bleeds. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Hallelujah to the Son of Suffering. Your cross, my freedom. Your stripes, my healing. All praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever. Your blood, it's still speaking. Your love, still reaching. All praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever. Your cross, my freedom. Your stripes, my healing. All praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever. Your blood, still speaking. Your love, still reaching. All praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever. Glory to God forever. All praise, all honor. Glory to God forever. You deserve it. To God forever, forever and ever. Glory to God forever. Come on, church, will you just lift his name up right now? Come on, give him your best praise. Come on, all glory to his name this morning. All glory to his name this morning. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
worthy of our praise, but the Lord God Almighty. Lord, only you are deserving of any praise, of any worship. Your name is great and greatly to be praised. The name of Jesus. God, we worship you for the sacrifice you made for us, for the price that you paid, so that we have the chance to choose life over death, to be in relationship with you, to walk with you, to have freedom. God, you don't need a reason to be worthy of praise. So Lord, we worship you for what you've done for us, but more than that, we worship you because you're just God. Just who you are is worthy of praise. You don't have to do anything to be worthy of our worship. The name of Jesus is great and greatly to be praised, all on its own. So this morning, Lord, may our worship rise up and lift you up and bring glory to your name alone. To your name alone. Your name is great. We love you, Jesus. It's in your mighty, mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we give God praise one more time? Hey, thanks for worshiping with us. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good to see you guys. All you beautiful 10-15 people, glad that you're here with us. Hey, if we haven't met, my name's Gary, just part of our lead team here. Glad that you're with us, those of you in the room, those of you watching in one of our video venues here on campus, and all of you joining us online wherever you are. Welcome to you. In fact, come on, put your hands together. Let's welcome everybody watching online right there. You guys are awesome. You're with us wherever you are. And a special shout out if you're a guest here. Maybe you're a first-time guest. We're so glad, honored, really, that you chose to spend part of your weekend worshiping here with us. So just thank you. And we would love to connect with you. And the way we do that when we're together is through what we call a Connect card. So if you're here in the room, you've got a Connect card right there in your worship guide. If you are joining us online, you can click the Connect card link. And that's really all we ask of you, is just to complete that card. It's really short, just kind of your way to say hi. It allows us to kind of say hi back, and we can just stay connected as we go on. So thank you for completing that card today. And if you're here in the room and you complete the card, drop it off before you leave at one of our guest experience booths. There's one in the upper lobby, one in the lower lobby, because we've got a gift that we want to give you before you leave today. Just another way to say thank you for joining us here at Mountain West. And I want to let you know about a couple things going on. The first one is actually happening today. It's our young adult gathering happening right here on campus at 6:30. This is our ministry to our 18 to 30 year olds. Man, God's doing some exciting things in this. And I heard the last one was awesome. I don't really get to go to those, but I heard it was awesome. So if that's you, then be sure and be here this afternoon, 6:30 p.m. And then, hey, did you know it's only 3 weeks till Mother's Day? 3 weeks till Mother's Day. How does time pass this fast? Yeah. So, man, Mother's Day's coming up. We're behind the scenes right now in these last couple of weeks, putting some finishing touches on a great Mother's Day experience. So we just encourage you to spend your Mother's Day here at Mountain West. It's going to be amazing. And then the Sunday after that, May 19th, is our Graduate Recognition Sunday. And if you've got a student that's graduating, we want them to be a part of this day. In all of our gatherings, there'll be a special moment to recognize our graduates. I've got one of those this year, so I'm paying close attention. So you can scan the QR code. You can go to the student page on our website and make sure your graduate is a part of this special day. And then finally, I just want to say thank you again for your generosity, for your giving, your faithfulness. When you give, one more lives. It's the way we say it around here, because it really is an investment in a child, in a student, in a single, in a mom or dad. So just thank you for making a difference, for helping one more experience hope that they can find in Jesus. Thank you. There's four ways that you can give around here. You can give in our lobbies through our giving stations and our giving kiosk. You can give through the Mountain West app. You can give online, or you can text the number that you see. It'll just take you to a link. Whatever is easiest for you. Again, we're grateful for you and your investment in one more person that can experience hope. Hey, it's about time for the message, so you can follow along in the notes right there in your worship guide, or you can click that note link online. So let's continue today to find out how to be happy.
Well, good morning, Mountain West. How you feeling? Man, so good to see y'all on this beautiful, beautiful day. The reason why it's beautiful is because y'all are here, and I'm so glad that you decided to come to church today in the midst of the weather, whether you're in the room, in our video venue, however you decided to come to church today. We're just grateful, grateful. And let me just say, the last couple of weeks, just how grateful I am. I've gotten multiple emails or cards and just you guys, words of affirmation fill my cup, and y'all have been doing that. And on behalf of my wife and I, let me just say thank y'all so much for giving me the opportunity to pastor such an incredible, incredible group of people. And it's the honor of our life to serve at this church. So thank y'all. Thank y'all. Okay. So I want you to hear that, receive that, and now I'm going to pivot, and this has nothing to do with what I just said. Monday nights have been going incredibly, guys. I am very excited about what God is doing. Here's what we've noticed as a team, is that in the room, Monday feels like Mountain West, but one of the things that makes Mountain West Mountain West is what happens in the hallways and in our lobbies. And the truth of the matter is, you need a certain amount of people to create that and cultivate that energy. So in your worship guide, we've got an ask for you. Some of you, you've been wondering, how can I just serve my church and make a difference? And Lord, where are you calling me? Are you calling me to the nations? No, he's calling you right here to Monday night. And here's the ask. We need about 50 of you guys to partner with us and be missionaries and come on over to Monday night, mainly because I'm telling you, God is doing some stuff. We're reaching people on Monday night that we would not be able to reach otherwise. I remember the first Monday night, she's here now, Jerry, she pulled up and said, "Pastor, I only came so you wouldn't be preaching by yourself." And by God's grace, I'm not preaching to myself. We've got a good core group and so many testimonies, people who hadn't been in church and a few years, individuals, a single mom who works every weekend and wasn't able to go to church, and she's now able to come to church, and multiple couples who have not been able to worship together because one works on the weekend, and now they're coming to church on Monday nights, and people giving their life to Jesus on Monday night already, y'all. Can we celebrate it? Even if we stop it, I'm telling you, it was worth it for one more. It was worth it for one more. But we don't want to stop it. So I'm asking y'all to help us be Mountain West. Help us to help other people experience hope by taking their next step towards God. So you just pray about it. And if the Lord is tugging at your heart, do not ignore him. If he is knocking at that door, do not go back to the kitchen. Open the door and let the Lord lead you. Amen. All right, one other quick thing. Y'all, men's night was absolutely incredible. If you missed it, you missed it. I think we got a few pictures of men's night. It was really, really cool how God began to move. And, okay, we don't have the pictures. All right, anyway, here's what I just want to say to y'all. Ladies, they're here now. All right, ladies, here's what I just want to say is we use the men as the guinea pig so we can get your event right in the fall, okay? All right, there is something coming for the ladies. It's already in plan. And so don't worry, we haven't forgotten y'all. And look, you get Mother's Day and a Ladies' Day. You blink and Father's Day is gone. So it's cool. All right, we're continuing in this series called Happy Friends. And we're looking at a verse today, Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. And it says, "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Let's pray. Father, Today is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And I pray today for every heavy heart to be lifted. I pray today that even before we begin to declare your word, that your spirit would do what only you can do. Give us ears to hear and hearts to receive what you would say. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, friends, there are times where I feel like I'm living in a version of the Truman Show. I think, and if you don't know what that is, I'm sorry, I just dated myself. But I feel like the Lord lets stuff happen to me so I can tell you about it. I had one of those situations recently. I was traveling to speak in Myrtle Beach on Tuesday night. And one of the things that I like to do is I like to tuck my kids to bed at night. And so I'll fly later if I have to so that I can be with my family. And so I'm racing to the airport late at night and getting there. And I park in the parking garage and I get out of the car and I realize I forgot my wallet. I did not have enough time to go back home and get there. So my first step was, okay, let me check and see if I could get another flight in the morning that would get me there in enough time. Nope, that didn't work. Okay, so I said, well, I'm a man of faith. We're going to walk in here and believe God is going to do something that only he can do. So we walk into the airport, and I tried to go through one of the lines that will help you out with that, and they said, no, all of that is closed. You just got to go through general. So I go up to General, and I tell them the situation. I forgot my wallet. I need to get on this plane. And they said, stand over here. And then comes out this man who comes out, and y'all, you almost lost your pastor, because he comes out, and he says, where's your wallet? And I said, I left it at home. And he said, why'd you leave it at home? And so at that time, it started to rise a little bit. And so I'm holding it. But then here's the kicker. I said, well, I didn't do it on purpose. You know, sometimes these things happen. And he said, how old are you? When I tell you my blood pressure hit 1,000. And in that moment, I had two options. Do I give him what he asked for? Or do I hold my peace? Now, I chose the latter. And by God's grace, I got on the plane. And here's what I realized is, number one, I hope, and I'll never forget his name. I hope, insert, I ain't going to tell you his name just in case y'all know him, but I hope he finds Jesus. But if he wants to find him here, he's going to have to give me 6 months. And then the second thing I learned is as soon as I got back home, I went and got me an Apple tag, and I get an alert every time I'm 30 feet away from my wallet. And so here's the reality, friends, is that in that moment, I could have chose strength or meekness. And I chose meekness. And you know, a lot of times we think meekness is weakness. You think being meek means that people are running over you, or that you are just some timid and soft person. I would submit to you, meekness is not weakness, but meekness is actually strength under control. Meekness is deciding to be in control. In fact, let me frame it like this. Meekness is the personification of the fruit of the Spirit called self-control. Now, you ever been in the yard and you have the hose and you turn it on? It is so much easier to release power than to restrain power. Now, Jesus is calling us in a world that celebrates, right? It's not that we overtly celebrate bullies, but aren't we so much more impressed with people who can quickly tell somebody off when something happens? Aren't we so impressed when somebody just seems strong? And Jesus turns this thing upside down and he says, blessed are the meek. Not blessed are those who can show you their strength, but blessed are those who can control their strength. And sometimes we get this whole meekness and humility thing confused, right? They're not the same thing. Here's what humility is. Humility is the posture of your heart, where meekness is a decision of your will. Humility is who you are. Meekness is a choice you make. You either are or you aren't humble. But you can decide whether or not to be meek. You can decide whether or not you will release the power or you will control that power. And I tell you, friends, it's one of the hardest things to do. It's one of the reasons why I know the Lord was working on me, because Mr. TSA man should have got a mouthful. Y'all see I'm still processing, right? See, because here's what meekness is. Meekness is restraining of your natural will. It is a restraining of your natural will and walking in submission to God's desire for how you interact with others. Let me say it one more time for those in the back. Here you go. Meekness is a restraining of your natural will. What comes easiest and natural to me, and walking in submission to God's desire for how you interact with others. Humility is about what you think about yourself, and meekness is about how you treat others. Right? And even in the Greek, that word for meekness, they didn't really have many words for it. It's a word picture, because the Greeks did not celebrate meekness, similar to our society today. Right? We're disappointed when somebody doesn't fight back. But the word picture is of a stallion who is been tamed and submits to the bridle and the bit. Here's what the stallion does, is submits to an authority greater than their own. And here's what the Lord is calling us to do. Is that if we are going to be happy the way he designed, is to not let our natural will to control our lives, but we have got to be controlled by the Spirit of God and be submitted to who he has called us to be. God's not looking for strong warriors in their own might. He's looking for meek, submitted people who are willing to follow him where he has called them to be. Let me frame this. A biblical picture of meekness are those who fully trust in God. And if I could give you the end of the message before the beginning, here's what I need you to understand. God trusts those who trust him with what he has. Those who trust God, God trusts back with what he has. Now, if you're saying, preacher, pastor, I don't know how to be meek. What are some things that I can do to be meek? Here's some practical, if you're saying, I want to grow in this area, here's some practical things that you can do. Number one, practice grace. Here's one of the number one things that prevents us from being meek is we don't moderate our expectations of others. Here's what we do. We expect others to be perfect, and we have grace for our own lives, for our own imperfections, but we are, oh my gosh, over somebody else who doesn't walk in the pristine perfection that we have standard for them. And this is an aside, but friends, please stop trying to hold people to a standard that you won't live up to yourself. First place of meekness is to practice grace. The second place is to practice gratitude. Hear me, friends. You cannot be meek and entitled at the same time. Gratitude is an essential aspect of meekness. You've got to be thankful for what you have instead of entitled to what you have. Here's the third practical thing you can do if you're trying to grow in meekness. Is practice celebrating others. There is nothing that kills jealousy like celebrating your neighbor. It's hard to be jealous for somebody you're proud of. Here's the fourth thing. This is real practical and simple, is make friends with meek people, right? Well, if you went to my grandmother's school, here's what she said, birds of a feather. Oh, okay, amen. Y'all in the right place. Here's the point, friends. One of the simplest ways to grow in meekness is to get around somebody who's already walking that out and allow them to influence you in that place of meekness, okay? Remember what we said, meekness is the personification of the spiritual fruit of the Spirit, which is self-control, and meekness is not weakness, it's strength under control. Now, here's what I wanna do. I wanna show you four blessings of walking in meekness, four things that will elicit and produce Jesus joy in your life by walking in meekness. Number one, meekness frees you from the spirit of comparison. I'm telling you, friends, comparison is the thief of joy. And some of you right now, the reason why you can't have joy is because you've been stuck looking at everybody else, looking and comparing yourself to everybody else's story, everybody else's journey, everybody else's situation. And here's what the Lord will say to you today is don't let comparison steal the joy that I have for you. Don't get robbed of the joy that I have for you by focusing on everybody else. And here's what comparison does. It literally takes your value outside of what God has deposited in you and makes your value a moving target based on somebody else's experience. And so now, instead of having a steady graph of what your value is, now you've got a schizophrenic graph of where your value is based on who you're comparing yourself to. And let me tell you, I forget who says it, but they said it like this. Comparison is violence against oneself. You are literally hurting your soul by walking in comparison. And here's where you walk to. If you're comparing, I either walk in pride and make myself an enemy of God because I think I'm better than other people because I'm not like them. I either walk in jealousy because I don't have what they have. Or I walk in discouragement because I don't think I'll ever be able to accomplish what they accomplished. And all of them are far away from what God wants you to be. Can I show you what Galatians 6 and 4 says? Let me paraphrase. It says, mind your business. No. Here's what it says. I'm sorry. That was my version. Here's what it says. Pay careful attention to your own work, for then you will get the satisfaction of a job well done, and you won't need to compare yourself to anyone else. Get your eyes off of other people and focus on the calling that God has given you. God has great work for you to do. God has a great assignment for you to do. And if you're so focused on what he's doing in everybody else's yard, you're going to waste the place that God has given you right here and today. Being meek says, God, I don't have what they have, and I haven't done what they've done, but I thank you for what you're doing in my life right now. God, I thank you for the opportunity that you have right now. I may not be where they are, I may not have what they have, but Lord, you have done a work in me already, and I'm thankful for it. And I trust you with my life. Here's the second part that meekness, how it elicits and produces joy, is meekness focuses your attention on Jesus. Here's what I learned. It's not enough to focus on your calling. You gotta focus on the one who calls. Because if you're not careful, you will do the work of ministry and not know the Lord of ministry. If you're not careful, you will be busy doing stuff for God and not know God. If you're not careful, you will let the things you do for God zap you of the intimacy of following God. And here's what meekness says, is that the stuff I do and the stuff I have pale in comparison to knowing God.
that knowing him is the most important aspect. And I've got to focus my attention on Jesus. So in the Gospels and in the New Testament, Apostle Peter, he is one of my favorite characters. He writes the most about meekness because he struggled with this. He was not strength under control. He was strength fully released, right? They come to the garden to come get Jesus, and Peter, outgunned and outmanned, takes out a sword and cuts off somebody's ear. And if he was a better swordsman, he was a fisherman, he probably would have got his neck. He didn't aim good. Right? Peter was relentless. And the thing Peter struggled with is he always saw what everybody else was doing. Jesus comes to Peter and says, Peter, I've got a great calling for you. I've got major ministry for you. I've got an assignment for you. And Peter says, what about him? Not like, hey, can he come along too? No, he was like, yeah, that calling is good, but what you gonna do with him? Is mine better? And here's what Jesus said to him. Mind your business. Let me show you. Jesus said it nicer. John 21 and 22, Jesus replied, if I want him to remain until I return, what is that to you? Why does that matter to you? Here's what he says. As for you, follow me. Here's Jesus' assignment for you, friends. It's not for you to get caught up in what he's doing in somebody else's life, but to focus your eyes on Jesus. You know what makes a meek person strong is that they realize where their strength comes from. My strength doesn't come from the accolades you give me. My strength doesn't come from what I accomplish. My strength doesn't come from the position I have. My strength comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. My strength comes from the hills. And as long as I can see him, I'll be okay. And here's what the enemy wants you to do, friends. Get distracted so that you will miss what God is trying to do and who God really is. To get so distracted with the stuff and the happenings that you miss who Jesus is. You know, the challenge, Matthew 6 and 33, it's latter part of this whole Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. It's not enough to have a calling. You've got to seek the face of God before you seek the hand of God. You've got to know him for yourself. And here's one of the slick baits of Satan. It's to convince you that without his blessings, it's not enough. Can I tell you, friends? Jesus is enough. That you don't need all those other things. You think you do. Those are things you want. And it's not that God won't give those things to you. Here's the reality. The only thing you need in this life is Jesus. The only thing you need permanently for eternity is Jesus. And we get distracted by so many other things. I remember I was journaling in prayer, and I mean, y'all, I was just telling God all the things that people were doing and what happened and And I was just like, and I just had an epiphany. This is a moment of time that I got to spend with God, and I missed it. I got distracted by what everything else happening, and I missed the fact that in his presence there is fullness of joy. At his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. That in my moment of need, instead of focusing on Jesus, I really was just focusing on my problems and telling him about it. Here's what Hebrews 12 and 2 says. It says, looking away from all that will distract us and focusing our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of faith. Here's what Psalm 23 and 1 says in another translation. It says,
The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. You know, the more you see Jesus, and my grandmother is going to get upset with me because I'm not going to quote her song right, but let me paraphrase it. When you look I'm not going to say it right. But the more you look at Jesus, the cares of this life seem to fade away. The more you focus your attention on him. Here's the third thing that I think how meekness produces joy, friends, is meekness activates the protection of God in your life. Y'all don't miss this. Here's one of the beautiful parts about meekness is that meekness, because you put your trust in God, he becomes your defender. Remember, I talked to you about the bait of Satan, right? One of the other major baits of Satan is to cause you to put your hands on stuff God never intended for you to touch. Here's one of the best ways God protects you is to keep your hands clean. And here's what happens, friends. Someone does something unrighteous to you, and their unrighteousness provokes unrighteousness in you. And if you're honest, you feel justified because they started it. But their unrighteousness and your unrighteousness is both unrighteousness. And here's what the Lord is trying to encourage meek people to do, is to let God be your defender. That you don't have to fight every single battle. In fact, it's the enemy tempting you into saying, oh, it's pride in reverse because you're saying, oh, no, I got to fight because nobody's going to speak up for me. Can I tell you, God will show up in rooms that you are not to defend you, that you don't have to fight these battles. Let me tell you what happened, friends. Miriam, it's in Numbers chapter 12. It's an interesting situation, right? So Miriam and Aaron, who are brother and sister of Moses, get mad because they don't like Moses' wife, right? For whatever reason, they don't like her. And so instead of just being honest and being like, Moses, we don't like your wife, and let's talk about it, they start saying stuff like, is Moses really the only person God talks to? Like, God talks to me. Why is he the leader? Why is he the one that's doing this stuff? Let me show you what she said, Numbers 12, 2. And they said, has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also? And the Lord heard it. Can I tell you, friends, that the Holy Ghost is a secret camera in rooms that you ain't in and hears what you haven't heard, and he will defend you before you even hear about what has happened to you? And instead of trying to fight the battles yourself, here's what Moses did. Here's what Moses talks about. Now the man Moses was very meek, more than all people who were on the face of the earth. He practiced meekness, which was trusting God, not just with his life, but with his reputation. He trusted God was able to handle every circumstance that was coming to him. And my question is, where are you fighting that the Lord desires to fight for you? What? And here's what you don't realize, is once you put your hands on it, you take God out of the equation. Now, I was 15 years old when I realized wrestling was fake, y'all. It was a sad day. There was a man on the way out who said, now, Pastor, I enjoyed that message, but the one thing I'm upset at, I'm 48, and you just told me wrestling was fake. I said, sir, we have other things to talk about. The fact that you didn't know that the people's elbow was landing on the mat and not that. Okay, never mind. Anyway, but here's what they would do in wrestling. They had this thing called the tag team. And the tag team, there would be one guy who would go in first, and he would exhaust himself fighting. and he would exhaust himself. And when he was at his wit's end, then he would tag the other guy in, and he was fresh, and he was able to beat the other people up. And honestly, it's a picture of our life. We wait until we have exhausted everything. God, would you help? I'm on my wit's end. Lord, would you help? Then there was this new tag team grouping that understood it. The guy in the ring at first didn't wait too long. As soon as he knew that the person he was fighting was bigger than what he could handle on his own, he'd run to the corner and tag his person in. And some of you, the most practical thing that you can do today is stop trying to fight it on your own and say, Lord, this is your mail. This is your situation. God, I surrender it to you. I trust you with it. There's some of you, you are dealing with challenges at work right now. People saying things, people doing things, and you've been trying to fight it on your own. And here's my question to you. Do you really believe God is your defender? Or do you think you're your defender and you're hoping God will just bless your work? Here's what happens, friends. Numbers 12, 8 and 9. Moses never talks to them. God calls all three of them to a meeting, and he says, why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? And the anger of the Lord was kindled against them, and he departed. Here's some practical advice for some of you, right? Maybe many of you. The best thing you could do today is be quiet. Maybe you need to just stop complaining and stop trying to do it on your own and invite God in and give him full control. Here's what Exodus 14 and 14 says. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent. The Lord will fight for you. You just need to close your mouth. And I know that's hard sometimes. You just want to tell them. They need to know. Because if I don't tell them, they won't know. And you know what it really is? You just want to feel better by getting it out at them. And in that, here's what you're choosing. You're choosing your will over God's will. And here's what the Lord is saying. Can you trust me even if you don't get a chance to say it to them? And I know it's hard, because here's what I learned. One of the most dangerous things is a friendly smile. Because it be the same ones who's smiling in your face, strategizing behind your back. I learned that lesson early on. I don't got the time to tell it to you, but that, whew, another day. Here's the truth, man, friends. Meekness is refusing to fight battles that God promised to fight for you. I remember this hotel guy, he was there at the front desk, and some people said some mean stuff to him. And he called his supervisor and said, you got to handle this. And then the people kept being mean to him, and he said this iconic line, it's above me now. It's some of you, you need to stop fighting with the enemy right there, and you just need to say, it's above me now. The Lord will fight for me. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. I'm not going to touch it. It's above me now. Here's the fourth and final thing, friends, is that meekness activates the promises of God in your life. Here's the good news. Brothers and sisters, is that when we walk in meekness, here's the promise of that verse, the meek will inherit the earth. That when we walk in meekness, we get access to the promises of God. How do I know that? Here's what Psalm 24 and 1 says. The earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world and all its people belong to him.
And I don't know how to stress this enough, but God gives his stuff to people he can trust. He desires to give stuff into your hands. And don't miss this. It's not just material things. Because we get caught up in stuff that's just going to burn away and be done with anyway. Right? You can't take none of it with you. You enjoy it for a moment. The only thing you can take with you to heaven is your family. But the stuff God wants to trust you with requires for you to put your complete trust in him. Here's what Psalm 24 and 5 says about those who trust in the Lord. They will receive the Lord's blessing and have a right relationship with God, their Savior. Hey, you'll get to receive all that God has promised for you. And I know, you know, it's challenging sometimes because it's like, well, what about, you know, what God has promised me in the dream, and you know the battle that I'm in right now, and it doesn't seem like it's happening the way that I want to. Here's what I've learned. Meek people understand that where I am now is not where I'm gonna finish, and I trust God with the process. That even when it looks dark and ugly, because I know God, because I know who he is, I'm gonna trust him with the process. Here's what Psalm 37, 10, and 11 says. In just a little while, the wicked will be no more. Though you look carefully at his place, he will not be there. But the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant peace. Here's what I need you to know, friends. That meekness puts a demand on the promises of God in your life. And for the meek, the promises of God will be fulfilled. Let me close with this quick story, friends. There was this woman who was into science, and she was coming up with these formulas, and the Lord told her that he was going to advance her career and put her in this position at the top of her company. And she was just, you know, entry level, but she believed the word of the Lord, and the Lord started elevating her and positioning her, and she was at the point where it was now between her and another person. And the person said, you know, let's not compete. And they came to her and said, let's work on this project together. And what they did was they let her do the work, and they stole her idea and went to management first. And they gave him the promotion. And friends, she was hot under the collar. How could this happen? What? God, you told me. But she practiced self-control. She walked in meekness and said, Lord, I don't know how you're going to do this, but I know you're going to vindicate me. I know you're going to work this out. Well, friends, there became a challenge with the formula. And unfortunately, because he didn't create it, he didn't understand how to fix it. And so he had to call her into the meeting. And when they found out that she created it, he got demoted, she got elevated. And sometimes, friends, you are worried about the enemy, but the Lord says he prepares a table before you in the presence of your enemies. They gotta show up for the elevation. The promises of God are yes and amen. Believe God, not your will. Trust him with your life, and he will fulfill his purposes for your life. Would you stand with me? We're going to pray. Meekness isn't popular, but it's scriptural. And meek people will choose to make God please than to find favor with people. Because if you find favor with God, here's what the scripture says. If your ways please God, even your enemies will be at peace with you. Trust the Lord. In a moment, we're going to pray. Here's the greatest place that you can trust God. It's with your life. Trust him in the place of salvation. Jesus died so that you can have life and have it eternally, and to make you into the person that he wants you to be. Today is the day for you to choose meekness and choose to follow the example of Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for your people who have heard your word. And Father, I pray that you would do what only you can do with your word, that you would cause it to bring forth fruit, God. Lord, I pray that this will be a house that walks in meekness, Lord. God, would you help us to stop comparing and focus our attention on you? Would you help us not to see the left and to the right and get distracted, but to center our focus on you? Father, I pray for every single person that is in a battle right now. Family battles, God. Relational battles. Employment battles. Father, I pray that you would be the defender of your children. That you would give us the self-control to take our hands off of it and trust you with the problem, because only you can fix it. Father, I pray for the person that needs to say yes to you. I pray for the person that needs to be in right relationship with you. I pray today would be their day. And if that's you, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Lord Jesus, save me. Change me. Make me into the person that you want me to be. Forgive me of my sins. Today I put my trust in you. I receive your salvation. And Father, I pray right now over your people who have been in the waiting room. And Lord, I just pray that this will be the season where the promises of God are yes and amen. This will be the season, God, where you open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that we don't have room to receive. God, I pray this week for open doors. I pray this week for promotion. I pray this week, God, that you will do what only you can do. And we will give you the glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' mighty name. Every heart say amen. Amen and amen. Would you put your hands together for Jesus one more time? Hallelujah. Friends, our prayer partners are here down front. If you need prayer for anything, today is your day. And let's worship God. Remember his faithfulness.
your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same I will praise your
Well, we're a church that's all about helping one more experience hope by taking their next step towards God. Maybe you took a spiritual step today. Maybe you took the most important step of all, is committing your life, surrendering your life to Christ for the first time. Believing what Jesus did for you on the cross, that he paid the price, the penalty for your sin, so that you wouldn't have to. So that you could have a relationship with him both now and forevermore. Just realizing, man, I need to turn this thing. I need to repent. It's what the Bible says, to turn around and make Jesus my Savior and my Lord. And I'm just going to give control to him. If you made that commitment today, it's the most important decision you could make. And we would love to know about this next step in your life. So if you did that today, please let us know right there on the Connect card. Committing my life to Christ for the first time. Online, you can click Next Steps. I'm following Jesus for the first time. And if you'll let us know on the Connect card, you could either drop that off in the bins by the exit doors, or even better, drop that off at one of our guest experience booths, and they can help you know your next steps after that. So please let us know. And if you need prayer, let us know that. And maybe your next step is our Next Step class, which happens every week during our 10:15 and 11:45 gatherings on Sunday. It's where you find out all about Mountain West, how to become a member and all of that. But even more importantly, how to get plugged into a family and how to learn about how God's wired you to make a difference and minister to other people. So that's our Next Step class. And then I just want to thank you one last time for your giving and your investment and one more so that they can experience hope. Thank you, guys. Hey, we always end our time together by just speaking this blessing over each other. It comes right from Romans 15:13. So I'm going to say it out loud over you. You just speak it out loud over everyone around you. Here we go. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you, guys. Have a great day.
Wasn't that a wonderful word, a wonderful time of worship? Solid.
Yes, amen.
Meekness, meekness. May that be in our minds and our hearts for the rest of the week.
Absolutely.
And I even pray that that gentleman somehow sees this message, right, and turned his life around. Because, man, as his friend, Pastor Mo's friend, I'm like, hey, man, if I see him, no, meekness.
I know that's right. And, hey, if you made the decision to follow Christ today and make him Lord of all, that is the most important decision you could ever make, and we want to be here for you. So please, just like they mentioned in the gathering, you can fill it out on the Connect card and drop it off on your way out. Or if you watched online, please fill out the online Connect card link. The words are crazy. And make sure to connect with us, because we'd love to walk you through these next few steps.
Yes. So just a few don't forgets. Young Adult Gathering tonight, 6:30.
Yes.
Family Connect, April 28th.
Yes.
Mother's Day, May 12th.
Yes.
Graduate recognition. Let me try that again. Graduate recognition.
Recognition.
My goodness. That is May 19th. Remember, register by May 6th. Yes. Do it now so you don't forget. I've missed the deadline of registration because I just kept pushing it off. Student summer camp in June.
Yes.
A lot going on because there's a lot of us around and we all need a lot of different things.
That's right. So we hope you guys have a great rest of your Sunday today.
Yes. Be blessed, and we'll see you this same time next week.